The next method is hormonal methods. Under hormonal methods, you have the dominance of OCPs or oral contraceptive pills. You have various types of OCPs. You have combined pills, the postcoital pill, the male pill, the progesterone only pill, the once a month pill, and the phased pill. Out of all these, what is most frequently used and what is most widespread used is the combined pill. So coming to the most important, the OCP. OCP, as you know, is oral contraceptive pill. It is a combined pill. It has got progesterone and estrogen components in it. It is most effective and most popular method of contraception available. The success rate of OCP are astoundingly high. You can look at your slides right now. The figure of 99% is written. The success rate of OCP is almost 98 to 99%, which means it is almost an infallible method of contraception. What is the constituents of OCP? You have ethinyl estradiol, which is conjugated with these two components, norgestrel or levonorgestrel or desogestrel. These are the various generations of progestins. So any one of these can be available, but one standard component is the ethinyl estradiol component of the OCP. One tablet is taken onwards from the fifth day for 21 days. Now here, there can be a bit of confusion. What do you mean by the fifth day? When do we start counting the menstrual cycle? How it is counted? We start counting the menstrual cycle from the first day the menses starts. So we say when the menses starts, that is the first day. And from the fifth day, then we start the pill for 21 days. Please make this very clear. The first day of the start of the cycle is called the first day, and then the fifth day from that. From here on, we start the OCP and it is continued for 21st day. After that, the pill is stopped and we wait for the withdrawal bleeding to happen. In this case, the bleeding that happens is not normal menses. It is scantier and therefore it is called as a withdrawal bleeding. So we wait for the withdrawal bleeding and again from the fifth day, we start the OCP again for 21 days. So this is how a schedule of OCP is started and this is how it is maintained. There are a few couple of important questions to address here. What happens if one day the patient comes in and says, "Doctor, I was taking OCP, but one day I missed a pill. So I forgot to take the pill." What happens in that case? In that case, as soon as possible, the patient should take two pills on the next day. So if she misses on one day, the next day she takes two pills. Okay, so that was the solution. Another patient came in. She was more forgetful. She said, "Doctor, I forgot two pills on two consecutive days. So I missed two pills on two consecutive days. What should I do?" In that case, you cannot afford to be lenient. Remember, contraception is not guaranteed. If 2 days the pills are consecutively missed, contraception is not guaranteed. The cycle would be restarted and a barrier method would be recommended for the rest of the cycle, because contraception in this case cannot be guaranteed. So the answer would be, use an alternative barrier method of contraception and restart the cycle. Mechanism of action of OCP. So how does a OCP act? It acts by the inhibition of gonadotropin release, and you know that because gonadotropin is not released, obviously there will be no LH surge, and since there is no LH surge, there will be no ovulation, and if there is no ovulation, obviously you don't get a pregnancy. So that is the primary mode of action. So what is the primary mode of action? All these options can be listed. What you should know is the most important mechanism of action is the suppression of the gonadotropin release. The rest of the actions are thickening of the cervical mucus by the progesterone component of the pill. Progesterone is a hormone which is pro-gestation. So it is for gestation. Once a pregnancy is there, progesterone does not want many other sperms to enter, and therefore it thickens the cervical mucus almost to form a cervical mucus plug. So this is a miscellaneous action and this also contributes to the contraceptive effect. Hostile endometrium. There are changes into the endometrium which render the endometrium hostile for nidation. a site for implantation is not afforded and therefore pregnancy does not ensue. Increased tubal and uterine contractility. Again, the contractility of the fallopian tube and the uterus becomes hostile and implantation does not take place. These are the miscellaneous modes of action of OCP. What are the side effects of OCP? Let me tell you here first, side effects of OCP are abound. They are many, but most of them are not very serious, and if you use them judiciously, these side effects can be completely avoided or at least minimized. So let us see what the side effects are. You can have the regular nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, that is a given with any drug, and worsening of migraine. So a patient who has already migraine, it becomes not an absolute contraindication but a relative contraindication. Migraine patients can get aggravation. Again, an MCQ can be asked, why is this migraine getting activated or why is it increasing in frequency? That is because of the progesterone component of the pill. Progesterone can cause water retention in the body, which can cause a bit of edema, increased weight gain, headache and aggravation of migraine. So remember, that could be because of the progesterone component of the pill. Then you can have breakthrough bleeding or amenorrhea. Not a very good thing to happen. Okay, females obviously do not want that they would have breakthrough bleeding, because then the cycle completely becomes unpredictable. Sometimes breakthrough bleeding may occur and you can have amenorrhea. Amenorrhea, as you know, is the absence of menses. The menses simply do not occur. The breakthrough bleeding does not occur at all. That is amenorrhea. Mastalgia, that is breast tenderness or breast pain. Weight gain, acne, increased body hair can also occur. Increased body hair is called as hirsutism. You can have chloasma. What is chloasma? Chloasma is increased pigmentation. It is usually found on the face. So that is chloasma. You can have pruritus vulvae. You can also have carbohydrate intolerance. So your insulin glucose tolerance test. So your glucose tolerance test can be thrown off the charts. Okay, glucose tolerance test can go wrong and you can have an increased level of blood sugar. So it is not very congenial with carbohydrate. The balance can be thrown off. You can have deep venous thrombosis and you can also have pulmonary thrombosis. So it can potentiate thrombosis also. Going on further, coronary and cerebral thromboembolisms can cause myocardial infarctions and stroke respectively. These are serious side effects. Increased breast and cervical cancers. That can also happen in a minority of the population. But to just compare and contrast, I have written here what are the cancers to which this is protective. OCPs are protective against endometrial and ovarian cancers. So the risk of endometrial and ovarian cancer is actually decreased. Please remember this. Breast and cervical cancer, the risk increases. Endometrial and ovarian cancers, the risk decreases. Okay, if you want to remember this, externally the risk increases, breast and cervix. Internally, as you go inside endometrix and the ovary, the risk decreases. So externally the two organs, risk increases. Internally, endometrium and ovary, risk decreases with OCP. Benign hepatoma can occur and you can have gallstones. Again, gallstone is because of the slowing of the motility of the smooth muscle, which can result into gallstones. Contraindications of OCP. What are the conditions wherein OCPs should not be given to the patient? Remember, OCP is a very good contraceptive method, so these are important to be known. The absolute contraindications for OCP. First is history of thromboembolic disease. If the patient is having a history of thromboembolic disease, you don't want to progress the disease. So therefore, that is the first absolute contraindication. Second is moderate to severe hypertension. Let me tell you here itself, mild hypertension is a relative contraindication, but moderate to severe hypertension is a absolute contraindication. Hyperlipidemia, you should not prescribe OCPs because OCPs can derange the lipid profile. Active liver disease, genital or breast malignancies, absolutely not to be given. The porphyrias and impending major surgery. For all these things, OCPs should not be given.
What are the relative contraindications? The relative contraindications are diabetes, as we saw, sugar metabolism is disrupted, obesity, smoking, undiagnosed vaginal bleed, uterine fibroids, above 55 years, OCP should not be given. For that matter, above 35 years, they should be used with caution, because above 35 years, automatically a lot of risk factors increase, and therefore they should be used with caution above 35 years. In cases of mild hypertension, as I told you, again reminding you, mild hypertension is a relative contraindication. Moderate to severe hypertension is an absolute contraindication for the use of OCPs. Migraine, gallbladder disease, and lactation. You do not want to suppress that lactation. If you take OCPs because of the estrogen component, you know estrogen is against lactation. So estrogen can hamper lactation and the baby will suffer. So you do not want to give an OCP when the mother is lactating. OCPs are protective in, you have protection of OCPs in ovarian cyst, endometrial carcinoma, fibroadenosis, ovarian malignancy, uterine fibroid, and dysmenorrhea. So these are the conditions in which OCPs are protective. Open your eyes, open your ears. OCP is protective. After discussing a very long list of the side effects and contraindications of OCP, we are finally arriving at a point where we say that OCP is protective in these areas. And if you ask me, yes, there have been a lot of questions on OCP and other contraceptive methods. This is high yield. Maybe sooner or later in some examination, you are bound to have a question on this. OCPs are protective in all these diseases. Please keep this in mind. Coming on to the phased pill. What is a phased pill? Phased pill is exactly what it says it is. It has got phased doses of drugs in it. Estrogen component is constant and the progestin component increases in a phasic manner. How many phases are there? We have two types of phased pills, a biphasic pill and a triphasic pill. Obviously, in a biphasic pill, the progesterone component increases once, so it becomes biphasic, and in a triphasic pill, the progesterone component increases twice, then it becomes a triphasic pill. But what is constant is the estrogen component. You have something called as the mini pill. Remember this, mini pill is a low dose progesterone pill which is taken daily without any gap. Why do you need a pill which is taken daily and without any gap? The only indication or a major benefit that you have with the mini pill is, since it is only progesterone, there is no estrogen, there is no suppression of lactation. So if a lactating mother wants contraception, she wants a pill, this is the pill you should prescribe, a mini pill. Taken daily, a single pill does not inhibit lactation. Norgestrel or norethindrone are used in the mini pill. The postcoital pill. Nowadays there is a lot of advertisement on TV about the postcoital pill. There is a lot of controversy and here we are discussing the postcoital pill. What is there in the postcoital pill is levonorgestrel plus ethinyl estradiol taken within 72 hours and repeat dose taken after 12 hours. This method is also called as the USPE method. So I've just written in the bracket, sometimes you may have an MCQ, not telling you the doses, the schedules, but just the name of the method. So levonorgestrel plus ethinyl estradiol taken within 72 hours for the first time and repeated again after 12 hours is one method of emergency contraception. The second method is levonorgestrel alone taken twice within 72 hours, but there should be a gap of at least 12 hours between these two doses. Don't get confused, there is nothing to get confused. What I am saying is, you just take levonorgestrel 12 hours apart, but both these doses should be completed within 72 hours of the unprotected sexual intercourse. So that is the second method. This is the preferred method. Taking only levonorgestrel 2 doses within 72 hours is the preferred method of postcoital contraception. The last method is mifepristone 600 mg single dose within 72 hours. Causes uterine contraction and bleeding. Therefore, no implantation. So these are the methods for postcoital pill or postcoital contraception. Please remember, postcoital contraception should not be used as a substitute for regular contraception. Postcoital pills or postcoital methods are not akin to condoms. Postcoital pills should only be used for what they say they should be used. It is an emergency contraception. Coming to the depot formulations, you have slow releasing depot formulations, which are injectables, subcutaneous implants and vaginal rings. Subcutaneous implants are relatively new. You have an example such as Norplant, which is a rod and it contains the drug which it releases slowly. It is usually implanted in the inside part of your arm or the inside of your thigh so that the scar looks minimal and the dosage is appropriately released. For postcoital contraception, you can have menstrual regulation, menstrual induction or straight away abortion. Coming to the depot formulations now, as we said, we have injectables, we have progesterone only injectables. The examples are right now shown on your slides. You have DMPA, probably the most commonly used substance, DMPA, depot medroxy progesterone acetate. Depot medroxy progesterone acetate, 150 milligram to be taken every 3 months. So this is wonderful, one injection and the contraception is afforded for 3 months straight away. The next option is NetN, and NetN can be given in the doses of 200 milligram at 2 months interval. So this has to be repeated frequently. And then you have DMPA, which is to be given subcutaneously. So the doses are modified accordingly. These are depot preparations, injectables for long-term contraception. If an MCQ is asked, a mentally challenged girl has to be protected against unwanted pregnancy, in that case, remember, depot formulations would be preferable. Combined injections, you have subdermal implants and vaginal rings. I already told you about subdermal implants. Vaginal rings are not very frequently used. Again, there are more of theoretical interest rather than practical application. What are the miscellaneous methods of contraception? First things first, miscellaneous methods should not be applied for contraception. Please do not rely for contraception on miscellaneous methods. They have a poor safety record and they are bound to fail. So don't risk pregnancy based upon these miscellaneous methods that we are going to discuss. Just for your academic interest, you should know abstinence. Okay, very nice. No sex, no pregnancy. Contraception achieved. Abstinence, not always possible. Coitus interruptus, again, a very bad idea. Coitus interruptus is pulling out the penis before ejaculation. A very bad idea. Pregnancy can still occur. There can be sperms which are present in the pre-semen, and therefore this is not a very good method of contraception. The third is the safe period method, or also called as the calendar method or the rhythm method, wherein you calculate the safe period and time sex accordingly. Here also there can be a lot of problems. As you know, menstrual cycle is not exactly clockwork. It goes ahead, it comes before. So therefore these days may vary far too much for your comfort, and it may so happen that ovulation has occurred and it results into a pregnancy. How do you calculate this? A very rough calculation, 14th day ovulation occurs, 4 days plus minus that. So from the 10th day to the 18th day, that is the unsafe period. Before that and after that, it is the safe period. This is a calculation for a female who has an exact 28 day cycle, and we hope that the ovulation is occurring on the 14th day. If the cycles are not regular, then this calculation would not work. Natural family planning methods and are breastfeeding and birth control vaccine. We already discussed breastfeeding. We saw that when the mother is breastfeeding, ovulation does not occur, and since the ovulation does not occur, pregnancy cannot result. Again, this is only sure if the mother is exclusively breastfeeding to the baby for 3 months. Post 3 months, this is not a guaranteed method. Birth control vaccines, again, academic interest, this is not really what you can go and buy over the counter. terminal methods. We have for males vasectomy, as you know, and for females laparoscopy and mini lap operation. We will see this in the next class. Thank you for now.